Hello students, welcome to my class Apatra Physics. In our lesson today, we will learn about the conservation of mechanical energy. According to the principle of conservation of mechanical energy, the total mechanical energy of a system is conserved if the forces doing work on the body or on the system are conservative in nature. Let us consider the motion of a body is in one dimensional only. Let us say conservative force F acts on the body such that it undergoes a very small displacement delta x. According to work energy theorem, we can say change the kinetic energy equal to the work done. And change the kinetic energy is written as delta k, where k represents the kinetic energy. Therefore, delta k equal to fx dx. Fx means f is the function of x, is variable force into dx for very small displacement dx. As the force is conservative, so the potential energy change is given by delta u, which is equal to minus of the work done by the conservative force. Just I am saying again, you know, and we have discussed in our previous class that change the kinetic potential energy, that is always the negative value of the work done by the conservative force, the negative of the work done. If work done by the conservative force is negative, then minus into minus, the potential change will be, potential energy change will be the positive. And if the work done by the conservative force is positive, then ultimately potential energy will decrease. That means change will be the negative. It is the relationship between the conservative force and the potential energy of any object when placed at that point. And we already know that conservative force is equal to minus du dx, that is a negative potential gradient, potential energy gradient, not potential gradient. And from this, we can write it. Now, adding number one equation and number two equation, that means delta k is the fx into dx, and delta u, that is the minus fx into dx. Adding these equation 1 and 2, delta k plus delta u, that is the fx dx minus fx dx, that is the 0 in the right hand side. Therefore, delta k plus delta u. Delta u here represents the potential energy, and delta u, that is the change in the potential energy. Therefore, delta k, that is the change in the kinetic energy plus change in the potential energy equal to 0. That means we can combinedly write delta of k plus u. That means total change in the potential plus kinetic energy is 0, and that indicates k plus u is constant. That means in that system, total amount of mechanical energy, kinetic energy plus potential energy, remains constant. So sum of the kinetic and potential energy of the body is constant over the whole path, and therefore k plus u is the e, that is the constant, e is the total amount of energy. And therefore, kinetic energy plus potential energy equal to mechanical energy constant. It means that individually, kinetic energy and potential energy may change from one state to another, but their sum or the total mechanical energy of the system remains constant under the conservative force. That means when the force in action, that is the conservative force, in such a case, there is a mutual interchange of the kinetic energy and potential energy. Total mechanical energy, that is the sum of kinetic energy plus potential energy, remain constant. Some point to be noted. Number one, the value of mechanical energy of a body depends on the frame of reference. That means if we take different frame of reference, so really the potential energy basically depends upon the frame of reference. If we take different zero energy level, then total amount of energy will be different. Therefore, we are saying here the mechanical energy of a body depends on the frame of reference. Number two, in some cases, the mechanical energy of a body may be potential energy only, where in some other cases, mechanical energy may only be kinetic energy. If k is the zero, then u is the zero. Obviously, then total energy also zero. However, when total energy E is zero, then it is not necessarily that kinetic energy is zero and potential energy is zero. In any example where the kinetic energy is always positive, and at that moment, if the object possesses some same equal amount of potential and negative energy, then total energy will be zero. actually K is always positive when U is equally negative, then K will be zero. So total energy will be zero, not K will be zero. So E is equal to K plus U, and therefore E minus U, that is the K, that is always positive. And that means E always greater than equal to U. Always, for any real example, any real situation, the total energy always must be equal to or greater than U. It is not possible that E less than equal to U in any cases. Always, because E minus U is the K, the value of minimum value of the K is the zero. Always K is the positive one. Obviously, therefore, E greater than U. Negative value of mechanical energy indicates a bound state. For example, electron in an atom, an artificial satellite revolving around Earth, both have negative energy, so in bound state. That means for a mechanical, for a system, if the total amount of energy now becomes negative energy, it is possible when the potential energy negative below the potential energy more than the kinetic energy. This type of system, which possesses total mechanical energy as a negative energy, that system is known as the bounded system. As for example, satellites are revolving around the Earth or any other planets, and their total energy is negative energy. And electrons, they are revolving around the nucleus. The total energy of the electron always negative energy. That means the electrons are bounded to the nucleus, are bounded within the atom, within the system. And that means it required this amount of plus energy to escape from the system. Therefore, this type of system, which possesses total energy as a mechanical energy as a negative energy, that system is known as bounded system. Number five, the total mechanical energy of a body is conserved if the forces acting on body are only conservative forces. And this mechanical energy only conserved, that is very, very important point, that only conservative forces acting on the system or in any action, the conservative forces are only involved. In such a case, mechanical energy of a body will be conserved. If any other non-conservative force involved in that action, in that event, at that time, and there will be loss of some energy in the other form, and mechanical energy will not be conserved. Now, conservation of mechanical energy for a freely falling object, now it is an example. Here we can see that the total amount of energy for a freely falling object, energy means mechanical energy, kinetic energy plus potential energy of body remains constant, that at each and every positions, the total amount of energy remains same. Let us say body of mass M is taken to be height H above the surface of Earth. As the body falls freely, its kinetic energy increases at the expense of potential energy. That means at the maximum height, when it is at rest, it has only the potential energy. And when it freely falls, you know it will move with acceleration, therefore velocity increases. As a result, speed increases and kinetic energy increases in lieu of the potential energy. And if we take the different points, at point A, that is H, a height above the ground, it is initially at rest, that is velocity zero. Therefore, it was no kinetic energy at all. At that point, it is only potential energy, kinetic energy body at A, that is the half mv square. Obviously, U or V, that is the zero. Therefore, kinetic energy at point A is the zero. But potential energy at point A, that is the mgh, the mg weight of the object, and h is the height with respect to this ground. Therefore, total mechanical energy of the body at point A, that is the m kinetic energy plus potential energy at point A, that is the zero plus mgh, and therefore total energy at point A, that is the mgh. Here we consider the at the ground level, the potential energy zero, that is it is zero potential energy level we considered here. Now at point B, where is the point B? Now it is any point between the A and C. C point is when it just strike the ground. B, any intermediate point. At that point, it has both some height from the ground, that is h minus x, if x is the distance moved in a certain time from the highest point to the point B. And at that time, it also gains some velocity. Let us suppose that velocity is the V1. Therefore, it possesses both type of energy, kinetic energy plus potential energy. Let us proceed. At a point B, let us suppose the body falls freely through distance x up to point B. V1 is the velocity of the body at B. Therefore, height of the body or body from surface of Earth, that is the h minus x. So potential energy of body at B, that is UV, that is the mg into h minus x. Kinetic energy of the body at B, that is the kb, that is the half m into v1 square at that point. And what will be the v1 square? We can find out from the equivalence of motion using relation v square minus a square equal to 2as. Now v square, that means v1 square at point B, we are taking velocity at point B, that is the v1 initial velocity, that was zero, and at point B the velocity is the v1, and therefore we can write v1 square minus 0 square is equal to 2 into g into x, where x is the vertical distance covered during this time interval to reach the point B. So in place of s, we are writing here 30 x, therefore v1 square equal to 2gx. Therefore kinetic energy half m into v1 square, therefore the kinetic energy is the mgx, and at the same point the potential energy, that is the mg into h minus x, because at this point height from the ground, that is the h minus x. Now total energy at that point B, that is the sum of the kinetic energy and potential energy, and that is the mgx, that is the kinetic energy, because we already derived it, mgx plus mg into h minus x, it is the height from the ground, and from this by calculation we get eb, that is the mgh, that is the total mechanical energy, sum of the kinetic plus potential energy, and b point, any point. Now result is independent of the x. From this also we can definitely say, since the total energy at any point not depends upon the x, it is the equal to the mgh. H is the height of the highest most point. Then we can say at any point on the, for the different value of the x at any point, the total energy, that will be mgx. Now at point C, C point means when just it strike the ground, when it just strike the ground at point C, and it has finally reached the point C on the ground, height of the body from surface of earth is now zero, and therefore potential energy of the body at point C, that is the uc, if you write it is uc, the zero. Let us v2 be the velocity of the body at point C. Now kinetic energy of the body, that is will be the half m into v2 square, and again from the relation v square minus e square equal to 2as, in this case also the u initial velocity, that means at the topmost point the initial velocity is zero because it was at initially rest, and when it just strike the ground it moves a distance total h, that is height of this, and therefore we can write here v2 square is equal to 2 into g into h. Using the value v2 square in equation 4, now if we put the v2 square here, we can get the kinetic energy at the point C when it just strike the ground. And that kinetic energy, that is equal to half into m into 2gh, that is mgh. Now total mechanical energy of the body at point C, that is the ec is equal to ekc plus uc, which is equal to mgh plus 0, that is again mgh. That means at any point between the point A and C, at point A, at point C, when it strikes the ground, in all cases, total amount of energy remain unchanged. Here, we obviously considering there is no other process rather than the gravitational force. Gravitational force, it is a conservative force, and the motion taken place under only the conservative force, gravitational force. Here, we neglect the air resistance. If we consider air resistance, then some amount of energy can be more, maybe converted into heat energy. At that time you cannot write this equation, but here we are considering there is no other process like air resistance, etc. Only the force is the gravitational force, and there is a conservative force, and we have proved now successfully that the body falls, its potential energy decreases and kinetic energy increases by an equal amount. However, the total mechanical energy of the body remains same at all the points during free fall. Thus, the mechanical energy of body is conserved during its free fall. At the highest point, the body total energy is potential energy, but at the lowest point, that is at the surface of the earth, the total energy obviously it is the kinetic energy. And if we see the mathematics or the expression for the kinetic energy or potential energy, kinetic energy at any point or potential energy at any point, and it is clear, for any point, it is proportional to the x. Kinetic energy at any point B, that is proportional to the x. That is very directly. And also the potential energy also, that is also changes with the linear equations. That means if we plot the variations in graph, we will get a straight line graph. And if we plot, it is a zero height, that means it is ground level. At the zero height, the energy, it is the kinetic energy, the blue line is the kinetic energy, that means kinetic energy maximum, and that is equal to total energy, that is kinetic energy plus potential energy. And at a height h, when we goes to higher points at height h, it has only potential energy. The black dotted point is the it represents the potential energy. And at any point, if we add the total energy, that is the kinetic energy plus potential energy, you will get the total energy, and the, this red line is representing the total energy, that is kinetic energy plus potential energy. And this variation is a linear variation, obviously. If you want to draw this type of graph, you should remind it that the variation is a linear one. That means you have to draw this, but at any point, total energy, that will be equal to the kinetic energy plus potential energy. And constancy total energy with height at any point, this one. Now another example. The potential energy of a string. First of all, we have to learn the potential energy of a string, and again we will discuss about the conservation of the energy, mechanical energy of a oscillating spring when any object is attached to the spring and that is oscillating. Let us consider an elastic spring of negligibly small mass. One end is attached to a rigid support and the other to a block of mass m. The mass m can be slide over the smooth horizontal surface. Now when the spring is stretched and or compressed from its normal or equilibrium positions by a small distance x, then a restoring force is produced in the spring which tries to bring it back to its normal positions. Figure diagram here, one object of mass m, it is attached to a spring, and one end of the spring is fixed with a rigid support, and the object of mass m kept on the on a horizontal smooth table. That means here we neglecting the frictional force of the table. Now it is the equilibrium position or mean position at that time when there is no deformation, no change in the configuration, it is normal state, and when it is, it will be at rest, the object will be at these positions. Now if we compress the spring in such a way that in this, when we compress, that means apply the force, external force opposite to this, at that time a restoring force is developed. That means it is due to the property of elasticity property. If any object is deformed from its normal configuration, then and force, internal force developed automatically within the object, within the spring also, within other object also, if you want to deform this. And it is due to the elasticity property, and this force always try to restore the object or the spring to its original shape, original positions. Therefore, this type of force which is developed within the spring or any other object when it is deformed, this type of forces are known as the restoring force. And this restoring force also a conservative force. Now, again, if you stretch from its normal or equilibrium positions, that means if we increase the length of the spring, at that time also one restoring force developed. And in all cases, we are observing here the external force and the restoring force, these are opposite to each other. Here it is experimentally proved that the restoring force developed, that is the proportional to the x. From the Hooke's law, the restoring force F is proportional to the displacement x from mean positions, or F vector varies x vector, or here we have to write minus k, x k is the constant, and k is a constant for the particular spring, k will be different for the other springs. Minus sign indicates the sign, the directions of the x and the restoring force. These two are always opposite direction. But the direction of the x and external force are same in both cases. When it is compressed, the x is right to left and the external force is also right to left. But at that time, the restoring force developed, that is left to right, that means opposite in directions. Always x and restoring force. It is opposite in direction. In this case, x is supposed positive here. It is the zero positions. X is zero. It is x is negative. And for this position, x is positive. External force is also in the same directions. But if restoring force developed within the spring, that is opposite in direction, that is the negative. So negative sign shows that the restoring force is directed towards the equilibrium positions. Here, k is the constant of proportionality known as spring constant. The spring constant is the restoring force developed per unit displacement of the spring. Numerically, we can write the restoring force divided by displacement. It is known as the spring constant K, and this spring constant depends upon the spring and its some physical or materials, physical structure, construction. But for a particular spring, K is the same. And K is directly proportional to the restoring force, or restoring force is also at any moment when we compress or stretch equal to the external force. Therefore, K, that is the restoring force per distance or external force per displacement or distance. SI unit of spring constant, obviously unit of force divided by unit of displacement, that is the Newton per meter. And CGS unit is the dyne per centimeter, obviously unit of force is dyne per centimeter. And you can also apply some other units, Newton per millimeter, Newton per centimeter, etc., etc. Navier-Stokes formula of the spring constant, that will be the F by L, that is M L T minus 2 divided by L, that is M L 0 T minus 2. It is the dimensional formula of the spring constant. It is a proportional constant, but it is not a dimensionless constant. It has some dimensional formula. K has some unit also. And it is the spring constant is the characteristics of that particular given spring, we can say. Since external force is just equal and opposite to the restoring force, since external force just equal and opposite, obviously in all cases the external force and restoring force is developed automatically due to the elasticity property, and external force, it is applied by some external agency. These two are always opposite in direction. That means opposite, and generally we have to apply equal and opposite applied force against the restoring force for the displacement. F external, that is equal to minus F, where F is the only F here we are writing here. It is the restoring force which is automatically developed. Therefore, F external force, that will be minus of minus K into X. So that means we can easily say that the external force and the displacement, these two are in along the same direction. Already we have discussed here, already we have see here, you can experience by experiment also that the applied force and the displacement along the same directions, and that is opposite to the direction of the restoring force. Let us, the spring is further displaced through a small distance dx. Then work done by the spring force, that is external force actually, that is the EF external dot dx, that is the external dx cos of 0 degree, and that is equal to k into x into dx. Therefore, total work done to stretch the spring through a distance x from normal to or equilibrium positions x equal to 0. And what is the total work done? And at any intermediate positions, the for the very small displacement dx, the work done by the external force, that will be kx into dx. And integrating the equation now for the whole displacement 0 to x, let us suppose starting from the 0 and the final displacement, that is the x from the mean positions. Then we have to take the integration by taking the lower limit 0 and upper limit x. And integration dw, lower limit x equal to 0 to upper limit x equal to x, kx dx, k is the constant for that particular given spring. Therefore, we can take outside k, and integration 0 to x dx, and integration x dx, nothing but the x square by 2, you already know it, 1 plus 1 divided by 1 plus 1, and lower limit is the 0, upper limit is the x, and therefore work done, that will be half into k into x square, and this work done will be stored in the spring in terms of potential energy. Here, work done against the restoring force, and that restoring force, it is also a conservative force, therefore work done that will be stored in the form of potential energy. But here, potential energy increases when the displacement increases. That means when the object is moved more distance from the its mean positions. But here, the variations of the potential energy, it is not linear. It is proportional to the x squared. That means nature of the variations of the potential energy, that will be parabola. And you know that W is equal to U is equal to half K into X square. This type of relation, it is nothing but the equation of a parabola. Therefore, the nature of the variations, if we plot a graph with X, variation of the potential energy, that will be parabolic in nature at x equal to 0, if we put x equal to 0 at that point, that means at the mean position or center position, the potential energy is 0. And when x increases, either stretched or compressed, when the x negative in this example, that means string is compressed, at that time also potential increases, but variations taken place to the square of the distance. And so therefore, the nature of the variations, that will be parabolic in nature. This variation of potential energy with the distance is shown in the figure diagram. This some information about the force on spring constant. Let us take some extra information or some knowledge about the spring constant. K, we already know from the Hooke's law, already we have stated that K is equal to F by X, where F is the spring force at any moment, that is also equal to the applied force divided by X is the displacement at that point. And obviously, this force is the variable one. Greater is the force constant of a spring, smaller will be the stretched or compression of the spring for a given force. That is, for the same x, if F is more, required force is more, then K will be more. And that means the value of the K, it gives us the concept, the stiffness of the spring, that means stiffer. Therefore, a spring with greater force constant, that means there are several spring which has more K, we can say it is more stiffer or stiffer than other, said to be stiffer. That means it is hard spring, one type of hard spring or stiffer. The spring with smaller force constant is soft spring, that means which is easily stretched or compressed, that type of spring is known as the soft spring. In such a case, less amount of force required for the same X, that means K is less. And it is the physical significance of the K. For the stiff K is the more, and for the soft spring, that K is the less. And F is the minus K into X. If X is equal to 1, F is equal to K into 1, that is K is equal to minus F. From this, we can define force constant. That's a force constant of a spring is numerically equal to the force required to produce unit extension of the spring. From this, we can define it. What is the force constant? That means unit for the unit displacement or unit stretching or compression, what is the amount of force required? And that is obviously at that moment equal to the restoring force. This force per unit length is measurement of the spring constant, and value of the K depends on the length of the spring. Let us suppose one very long spring, and we have take different cut into a different size, other factors same, material same, the thickness same, the diameter same, but the length only different. In such a case, the spring constant of the different spring, that will be different. And the which has the least length, that spring will have greater K. That means value of the K depends on the length of the spring. If we plot the variation of the K with the length of the spring, if all other factors are same, already we have stated that there was a very long spring and it is cut into several smaller pieces of different sizes. So, and if we find out the K for the different springs, then it will be observed that K varies 1 by L. Radius of the spring and nature of the materials of the spring of the wire. It is clear that for a spring K varies 1 by L, that is smaller the length of the spring, greater will be force constant or spring constant, and vice versa. And it is in our daily life experience also. If you take a smaller one, and if you want to produce a length, some specified, let us suppose 1 centimeter. And if you take a larger one of the same type of string, and if you want to increase the length 1 centimeter, then for the longer, it is very easier. Therefore, spring constant for the longer is less, and it is soft string, obviously. That longer strings are soft string, and shorter are the hard string or stiffer. Now, here also we can discuss about the conservation of energy. That means mechanical energy for an elastic spring. If a spring is stretched or compressed by a small distance x, then its potential energy is half k into x square. When it is released to move under restoring force till it reaches its normal equilibrium positions, that is x equal to 0. That means when you release it after stretching, then it is always try to reach its equilibrium positions, because it is its normal positions. At that position, there is no forces. At normal position, spring has maximum velocity, and the energy gain during the extension of the spring or compression of the spring that amount of work done that converted to potential energy, elastic potential energy. Obviously, when it returned back to its normal position or equilibrium positions, that kinetic energy convert potential energy convert into kinetic energy, and at the mean positions, central positions, the kinetic energy maximum, velocity maximum. Here, all the potential energy is converted into kinetic energy due to the inertia of motion. Now, spring overshoots the normal positions. Now, at the mean position, the net force is zero. There is no force acting on the spring, but it has some velocity. It gains some velocity for potential energy converted into kinetic energy. Therefore, it gains maximum velocity at that point. And due to the inertia, and when there is no force acting at that position, therefore, it overshoots. That means if it is at right, then it moves toward the left by crossing the mean positions. And if it is was in the left side, then it moves toward the right from the mean positions. Now, the velocity decreases till it momentarily stops and position x equal to minus x, where the whole kinetic energy is converted into potential energy. The restraining force again pulls the body towards the normal positions x equal to zero. Thus, the body keeps on oscillating between extreme positions. The total mechanical energy remains constant. That means, in this above example, if we now stretch and now release it, then it will start to oscillate about the mean positions from right to left, left to right, because when it reaches at the central position, no force, there is no force, but it gains some kinetic energy and it has velocity. If the inertia of motion, it overshoots and moves toward the left, and after gradually velocity decreases, again that kinetic energy converts into potential energy. At this extreme left point, it will be at rest, and therefore the kinetic energy again converts into potential energy. And after that, momentarily it will be stopped, and then it moves from left to right, again that potential converts into kinetic energy. And if we neglect this friction between the object and the horizontal table, it will oscillate, continue oscillate for a longer times. That means here only potential energy, here only kinetic energy, and between the point, these two extreme point, at any point it has both kinetic plus potential energy, because at any point there is a displacement x, also it has velocity, and therefore it has both kinetic plus potential energy. Here also the total amount of mechanical energy remains conserved. Conserve at this position, that extreme position, that is x equal to x plus. Let us suppose when x equal to x plus, then velocity of body is momentarily zero, that is v is the zero, and kinetic energy is the half m v square, that is also zero at the that point v zero. That means kinetic energy zero at extreme position at the both side, not only at the right hand side, x plus x minus. At the extreme position, when momentarily it will be at rest, at that time there will be no kinetic energy at all. And it has only potential energy, and already we have calculated it half k into x square, where x is the displacement from the mean position. Therefore, total mechanical energy at extreme position, that is kinetic energy plus potential energy, that is a zero plus half k x square, that is the half k x square. It is the total amount of energy, mechanical energy. It is the sum of both kinetic energy and potential energy. At that position, obviously, when object will be at rest, there will be no kinetic energy at all. It has only potential energy. At the mean positions, that is when x is zero, the velocity is maximum. That is kinetic energy k, that is half mv square, that is half k into x square. As the potential energy of the body is converted to kinetic energy, therefore potential energy half k x square, where at that point, mean point, the x is the zero. Therefore, potential energy is zero. Therefore, total mechanical energy k plus u, that is the half k x square plus zero, that is the half k into x square. At extreme positions, x equal to minus x. Here, x equal to minus x and v is the zero. Therefore, kinetic energy k, that is the half m v square, that is obviously zero. At the extreme position, again, the kinetic energy is zero. And here also the variation of the kinetic energy, also the potential energy, that is proportional to the square of the displacement from the mean positions. Therefore, if we want to plot if the graph, nature of the graph or variations of the both kinetic energy and potential energy, that will be parabolic in nature. It is a graph, it is a mean positions or zero positions, it is the extreme position plus x, and it is let us suppose minus x. At the it is the variation, this line is the variation of the potential energy. Naturally, potential energy at the mean position is zero, and gradually and parabolically increases at the end, extreme end, the only potential energy. And obviously, here the variation of the kinetic energy also parabolic in nature, proportional to the x square. And here at the mean position, the kinetic energy is the maximum, but potential energy is zero. Here the variation is not the linear. Already we have learned that variation of the kinetic and potential energy for a freely falling object, that is a linear one. But here the variation is not the linear one. It is not the linear one. As both the kinetic energy and potential energy depends on x square, so their graphs are parabolic. The total mechanical energy remains constant, so its graph is straight line parallel to displacement axis. Mechanical energy remains constant, so graph straight line. Total energy is the straight line, obviously, because it is remains constant at any point. If you add the kinetic plus potential, you get the total energy at any point that remains constant. Here also we are considering there is no dissipating force, no other non-conservative force. That means there is no loss of energy during this process. If there is will be any loss of energy, obviously then gradually both kinetic and potential energy decrease, and after some time when energy totally lost, it will be at rest. At our daily life it is observed, but here if we consider there is no other non-conservative force, dissipating force, in such case we always get the sum of the kinetic energy plus potential energy remains constant. Now potential energy of elastic string by the graphical method, we can also find out the potential energy in another method. The work done in the stretching the string, and hence the potential energy can also be calculated from Fx graph. The graph between the restraining force F and the displacement x of a block attached to the free end of a string as shown in the figure. Already we draw a graph of the potential energy and kinetic energy with a displacement from the mean positions. But what will be the variation of the force and the restraining force with x? When x is a negative, that means when the string is compressed, at that time the force is a positive, that means left to right. And the positive force, it is a positive force and it is a negative force. So when x is negative, force is positive, and when force is, x is positive, positive, force is negative. Somehow the area under the graph, according to the Hooke's law, the restraining force of an extension x is F equal to minus k into x. The work done by restraining force for an extension W, that is W equal to area of the triangle, this one area of this. In this case, the force is negative and distance is positive. Therefore, the work done that will be half into base into height, and that is F into x, half into x into x, that is the area of the triangle. This, that is AB into OB, half into AB into OB, and that is half into F into x. And the value of the F is the minus kx. When x is positive, k is the negative. When kx is the negative, when kx positive, x is negative. Ultimately, always we get what done by the restraining force, that is half into k into x square. What done by the restraining force, we are not saying the what done by the external force. External force, that will be the positive, but restraining force always here, the what done by the restraining force, that will be negative. So either stretch the string slowly and external force equal to F external equal and opposite to the F has to be applied. And thus the work done by external force, in such a case we can write that W is equal to minus of minus half kx square, that is half kx square. Already in our previous classes we know that the negative of the work done by the conservative force is the change in the kinetic energy. Here also, or change the potential energy, change the potential energy. So here minus of minus half kx square, that is half kx square. The work done in stored as potential energy of the string, hence U is equal to W external half k into x square. In another way, in the graphical method, similar here, we can find out the work done by the restraining force, negative of the work done by the restraining force, that is the change the potential energy. So when it is from zero to this x, and by the graph, we can also find out the work done by the restraining force, or what is the expression of the potential energy. It is another method, graphic method. Now it is end of this class, end of this lesson, and we will meet in our next class.